get excited. You're going to help me pray this. Say, Heavenly Father, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I ask you to show me what is in my hand. I want to see your mighty work revealed through me. In Jesus' name. I have influence. And Father, you anoint me in all areas of my life where your word has been made flesh. I will write. I will speak. I will speak. I will speak. I will sing. I will give. I will create. I will serve. I will steward my life wisely. I want to make a difference in my world and in people's lives. Show me the power of what is in my hand so I can be an answer to the problems that surround me. For the glory of God and His kingdom. In Jesus' name. Do you agree with that? Let's pray in the spirit a little bit. That's what He just told me to do. Go la 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 kioto. Ala la kioto kolora kioto kolora kioto kolora kioto. Yes, yo korriti, rio korriti, rio korriti, rio korriti. Aba korriti, microphone. Hoko la la microphone. Aba korriti, rio korriti, rio korriti. Abakoriete, rio koriete, rio koriete, rio koriete, rieki, rio koriete. Yes, Lord. Abakoriete, rio koriete, rio koriete, rio koriete, rio. Oh, leleleki, oh, leleleki, oh, lolokuto. Abakoriete, rio koriete, abakoriete. God says we're supposed to be like little children. We're supposed to be like little children, right? Remember our little Jaden? There was a lady that was sick. Well, she passed on to heaven. Praise God, she's in heaven. You don't know her. A lot of you don't know her. But little Jaden goes over and lays them little beady hands on her and prays over her and then prays scripture over her. What is that all about? To be like children. To be like children. Stephen, come here. I want you to tell me what your son did when you told about somebody at work that came from Cambodia. Wife.
Yeah, he came from Colombia.
You can sit down.
One of my coworkers, his wife and his 4-year-old son lived in Colombia for about the last 2 years while Carlos was working with myself. And they just moved here like 2 weeks ago and they didn't have much of anything. And so I'm thinking, you know, I just really want to bless. There's really a need there. And I'm thinking, do we have any clothes or toys or anything? And Keisha's like, well, I don't know about the clothes, but we have lots of toys. And so yesterday, I told him about this, and Samuel, and he's getting really excited about, like, yeah. So he started out giving, you know, we had about 4 or 5 boxes of toys that we're planning on going to Goodwill and giving. And so he got like 2 or 3 toys out of those. And then I said, well, why don't we really bless him? I said, because it's more blessed to give than to receive. And he's like starting to get into it. So he went into his private stash. And I said, you know, it says with the measure that you use, the thing, if you value something, that's what you're going to get back.
Yeah.
With what measure you use, it's measured back to you. And he didn't understand maybe that verbiage, but I said, if you give your best, you're going to get back your best.
Yeah.
And all these things that you've got on your vision board, you know, what you're believing for, I said, it's going to happen faster when you sow into someone's life. It's going to give and it shall be given back to you, good measure, pressed down, shaken together. And he's like, he's really getting into it. So, Keisha was kind of surprised at some of the things he was given, you know, some of the things he got last Christmas. She's like, well, I didn't understand. I didn't know that till today. She said it, but I'm like, yeah, give your best, because I just want to see. I'm excited to see, with that little childlike faith, what God's going to do. It's exciting. You hear about, I've been listening to Bill Winston for years, and you hear about what his son has done, and how he believes, you know, for a plane ticket to Hawaii or, you know, a car, even a car, and how God comes through every time.
Every time.
He's got that pure childlike faith, and it's exciting. I'm probably, and Samuel's like, well, when are you going to give it to? So we've got all the stuff. And I said, let's just get this, put it in the trunk. And then we went to Funset Boulevard, and I said, you know what? And he's like, when are you going to give that to him? So he's excited. I said, can you imagine how excited Carlos's son is going to be when he gets all these? It's going to be like Christmas for him. And he's going to be, I'm like, yeah, that's what it's all about.
Mm-hmm.
You know, finding, like you said, you know, what's in your hand, identifying a need. And then that's when, you know, you respond in faith. That's when you see the hand of God. And you're like, yeah, those promises are true, but yielding to the anointing, to the Holy Spirit, and letting Him lead you and guide your giving, that's when you really see, I've seen in my own life, when you do what He says, like the woman, you know, at the wedding, like whatever Jesus, whatever He tells you to do, just do it.
Just do it.
And
just
then
do
you
it.
Don't have to figure it out, just do it.
Mm-hmm.
It's not always easy,
no.
But I saw how easy it was for a little kid.
Yeah.
Some of us grown-ups, we like to hang on. Mm-hmm. More, but
well, you
it
know
encourages
what
encourages my faith to see what, you know, I'm excited because I know God, He has to come through. That's His. He's the one that puts. We're cheerful givers. He puts
that's
that in
right.
our heart to be givers.
That's right.
Because He knows. We know now, but His promises are it's going to be a great harvest.
Well, what I like is He went into His private stash. See, He was ready to give the stuff He was going to have a rummage sale for. But then He went into His private stash. But then, was that private stash His Christmas presents yet? Oh, and He got some nice Christmas presents, and He's ready to give it away. Why?
He's making room for the new stuff.
Thank you, Stephen.
Coming in.
Amen. He's making room for the new stuff. What a kid. But you know, it's not off. But you know, God says we're supposed to have the childlike faith. But how many times, what do? I got my stash here because, you know, I just want to make sure I don't lose this, and I got to keep something for that day when I need it. But then when you give it all away, and all of a sudden you go, oh, my goodness. But to watch, like him and little Jaden and Sammy, watch these two prosper in every area of their life. We'll have them little ones up here preaching because they know how to do it. But we're learning, aren't we? But you know what happens to the hearts? Not you folks, absolutely not you folks, but people's hearts get hardened. It just, because you know, we look at the world. So what we're going to do this morning is we're going to listen to another one of Jerry Savelle's tapes, okay? And this one is calling Develop a Lifestyle of Giving. Now, don't look at what God's trying to get from you. Look at what God's trying to get to you, because you're not just looking at finances, you're looking at that peace, you're looking at the overflow in every area of your life. Because like I said last week, you know, the devil is watching how we act. Oh, I gotta give this here. I don't believe Sammy could have had a hissy fit and kicking. He wouldn't have gotten his blessings if they'd have had to force him, right? That's why we don't beg for money at this church. That's why we're going to finish off that room, and we're going to, right there, write the vision, make a plan. All of it's paid for already. Is the money in the bank? It's in God's bank, and it has to be transferred over here. He will. Why not? Trust in the Lord with all of your heart. So He is developing a lifestyle of giving. Now, if you don't get the seven benefits of life of giving down, I will give them to you after. So don't worry about. Just listen to this, put down the scriptures, and let's go from there. Go ahead.
So far, we've learned a lot of wonderful things from the Word of God. I want to repeat what we've covered thus far. Prosperity is God's will for you. Knowledge and wisdom produce prosperity. The purpose of prosperity, Spirit-led giving, produces the fruits of righteousness. Why God's people are in financial bondage. Developing a lifestyle of obedience. Developing a lifestyle of faith. And now we're going to be talking about developing a lifestyle of giving. You know, the Lord taught me something a long, long time ago, many years ago, and that was this. You might want to write it down. You can sow your way out of any situation. You can literally sow your way out of any situation. I learned this by reading Genesis chapter 26. Most of you are familiar with it, but I want us to look at it once again. In Genesis chapter 26, in verse 1, it says, "And there was a famine in the land, besides the first famine that was in the days of Abraham. And Isaac went into Abimelech, king of the Philistines, unto Gerar. And the Lord appeared unto him and said, Go not down into Egypt, dwell in the land which I shall tell thee of. Sojourn in this land, and I will be with thee, I will bless thee and unto thy seed, I will give all these countries, and I will perform the oath which I swear unto Abraham thy father." Now notice once again the Bible says there was a famine in the land. A famine in Isaac's day would be like bad economy in our day, because when you went to measure Isaac's net worth, so to speak, you had to include sheep, goat, cattle, flocks, herds. And if there's a famine in the land, that affects all of that. You know, if you can't water them, if you can't feed them, then obviously that's going to affect your capital, your net worth, and so forth. So a famine in his land, or in his day rather, would be very much like bad economy in our day. But notice God said to him, don't go to Egypt. Stay in this land, and I will be with you, and I will bless you. What I take that to mean is, number one, don't go to Egypt. Don't run from the problem. Amen. Don't ever run from adversity. Don't run from your challenges. Number two, don't go to Egypt. That would say to me that God is saying to him, don't look for some other source. Let me be your source. I'm bigger than the famine in Egypt. Don't go to Egypt. Don't look for a way out of this other than looking to me. And then he says, stay in this land. In other words, you face this situation. You face this challenge with this knowledge. I will be with you. How many of you know if you know that God is with you, you can go through anything? Yes. Amen. And he said, not only will I be with you, I will bless you. What does bless mean? I'll empower you to prosper right in the middle of a famine. Now, the point that I'm endeavoring to make here is you can sow your way out of any situation. Notice in verse 12, then Isaac sowed in that land and received in the same year 100-fold, and the Lord blessed him, and the man waxed great and went forward and grew until he became very great. For he had possessions of flocks, possession of herds, great store of servants, and the Philistines envied him. So notice, in a land that is experiencing a famine, sowing in that land would seem foolish to most other people, would it not? I remember years ago, I had the privilege of being a farmer in England, Arkansas, and he was still a farmer when I met him. He was just beginning his teaching ministry. His name was Charles Capps. And I was preaching in Hot Springs, Arkansas, and after the service one night, this young lady came up to me and said, "You sound like my daddy." I said, "Well, who's your daddy?" She said, "Well, you don't know him. Not many people do, but one day they will. He teaches like you." And she said, "If I invite my mom and dad to come tomorrow night, do you think you might be able to go out and have dinner with them? I'd like for you to get acquainted." I said, "Sure." So she brought her mom and daddy to the meeting the next night, and it turned out to be Charles and Peggy Capps. And we went to dinner after the service, and Annette, his daughter, was right. Charles and I talked the same language. And it was an instant, relationship. And so Charles asked me if I'd come and preach in England, Arkansas. I agreed to come. They had an apartment above their garage, guest quarters above their garage. I stayed there in their home in that apartment, and we got even better acquainted, having meals together, being around each other. And I remember later Charles and I started doing a lot of meetings together all over Arkansas, particularly in small Assembly of God churches. Had a great time. And eventually, Charles's schedule and demand for his teaching became so great that he finally had to give up the farming part. But before he did, I remember one time I went to meet him and stay in his home in England. Then we were going to go out from there somewhere. And Charles said, everybody around here is saying it's going to be the worst year for farmers that we've ever had in a long, long time. I said, is that right? He said, in fact, most of my neighbors, and Charles farmed a lot of land. I mean, it's not a small farm, hundreds of acres. And he said, in fact, most of my neighbors are not even going to bother planting this year because there's going to be such a drought, it'd be useless to even plant, be a waste of seed. I said, what do you think about that? He said, that's not what God told me. He said, God told me I was going to have my best year. I said, wow. He said, in fact, since some of my neighbors are not even going to bother planting, I'm going to lease their land and plant on theirs too, because God told me it's going to be my best year. And he did exactly that. He sowed not only his field, but some of theirs as well. And they're standing back thinking, Charles Capps has lost his mind. But he had a Genesis 26 experience. God blessed him, and he did have a great year in harvest. And everybody else is wondering, why didn't we sow? Well, they let the world be final authority. Charles let God be final authority. Amen. Amen. And so notice here, even though in the natural it seemed foolish to sow in a land that's experiencing famine, but God told Isaac to stay there, that he would be with him and he would bless him. And Isaac sowed in that land. What is he doing? He's sowing in a negative situation. See, a lot of people only sow when things are going well. You know, well, I had a good week this week. You know, God blessed me financially. I believe I'll give a little extra to God. Well, that's wonderful. Keep doing that. But then when things get tight, people think, well, I better hold on to what I got. You never know. It might get even worse. No, that's the worst thing you can do. The Bible says, if you withhold, Proverbs 11, when you should be sowing, it will result in more want. Amen? You can sow your way out of any situation, no matter what it is. And here, Genesis 26 proves that. Isaac's obedience to sow, even when it looked foolish to others, put him in position to experience one of the greatest breakthroughs he'd ever experienced in his life. You know, when you're under financial attack, that's not when to hold back. That's when you sow more. You know, we made the decision long, long time ago that we may stop doing some things in the ministry, but we will never stop sowing. That's not an option. There was a man that worked for me years ago. He was my office manager and so forth, and a good man, had a good heart, loved God, and was a real blessing to me in the beginning when he first came to work with us. But he didn't understand this concept of sowing in famine. Everybody say sowing in famine.
Sowing in famine.
And we were experiencing some financial attacks in the ministry, and things were tight. And so I was praying about what to do. And the Lord had blessed me with my first airplane. It was paid for. And he said, I want you to sell your airplane and divide the money between two other ministries that are in worse shape financially than you are. And so I went into his office. I said, I need the title to my airplane. He said, why? I said, I'm going to sell it. And he said, oh, great. That'll help us a lot. You know, we need the money. I said, no, I'm going to sell it and I'm going to give the money to two other ministries that are worse off than we are. He said, you can't do that. I said, what do you mean I can't do that? He said, that's not logical. That's foolish. That's not good business. I said, would you mind walking outside with me? And I walked him outside and I showed him the sign on the building, Jerry Savelle Evangelistic Association. I said, you work for me. Don't tell me I can't do this. He said, well, I'm not in agreement with it. I said, well, then you have just finished your last day here. I'm not only going to sow the money from this airplane, I'm going to sow you into somebody else's ministry because I can't use you around here. You will not, and no one else will ever stop me from sowing. Yes. Amen.
Amen.
And so he left. obviously, you know, upset with me because he thought I was doing something foolish. So I sold the airplane, took the money, and divided it equally between those two ministries that were in need. Not only, now it didn't happen overnight, it didn't happen in a few weeks, didn't happen in a couple of months, but over a period of a few months, God blessed me financially, where I not only had enough to take care of all of our needs, but had plenty left over for reserve. Not only that, he blessed me with a bigger, better, faster, debt-free airplane. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Amen. I sowed my way out of a negative situation.
Amen.
Amen. Now, get to the place in your life where if you have to stop Starbucks. If you have to stop eating out every Saturday, stop eating out every Saturday. If you have to stop, you know, taking extended vacations, stop the extended vacation. But don't ever stop sowing.
Amen.
Amen? Amen? Don't ever stop sowing. When your attitude is stopping sowing is not an option, then you're now developing a lifestyle of giving, a lifestyle of sowing. And I'm telling you, we have sowed our way out of more crisis and sowed our way out of more adversity than I have time to tell you all the stories about it today. If you ask me, does sowing work? Yes, it works. Anybody that works here and knows the kind of sowing we do, they'll tell you, yes, it's worked time and time and time again. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Isaac's obedience to sow, even when it looked foolish, put him in position to experience the greatest breakthrough he'd ever experienced. You could say that the famine in Isaac's day would be like bad economy in our day, and if Isaac could sow his way out of a famine, we can sow our way out of bad economy.
Amen.
Can you say amen?
Amen?
But notice, once again, God's solution. Don't run from the crisis. Don't look for some other source. Sow in spite of it. Sowing opens the door to financial breakthroughs. But what really keeps that door open is developing a lifestyle of sowing and a lifestyle of giving. In Proverbs 11, verse 24 and 25, it says, "The generous soul will be made rich. The generous soul will be made rich. And he who waters will also be watered himself." What is God saying? You cannot outgive me. No matter how much you give, I'll top it. You refresh others, and I'll see to it others will refresh you. The generous spirit will not only get back what he's sown, but God says the generous soul, the generous spirit, will be made rich. That means God will multiply your seed sown and cause your harvest to be far greater than what you sowed. Well, isn't that true in the natural? I mean, what kind of farmer would take, one seed, plant it, and expect to get one tomato off of it? You know, I mean, what's the sense of even planting it? He plants those seeds expecting to get 30, 60, or 100-fold.
Yes.
Amen? Well, God says we can expect that in our sowing, 30, 60, 100-fold. Now, let me tell you, one time, you know, we were going through a real tough time a long, long time ago, and I got really desperate. Man, it looked like the heavens had become brass. Man, it looked like this financial breakthrough was never coming. Finally, I said to God, "Okay, here's the deal. Forget the 30-fold, forget the 60-fold, forget the 100-fold. Just match me dollar for dollar." That was desperation talking. Amen. But he didn't do that. He blessed me with more than I had sown, because that's what seeds do. They produce a greater harvest. Sowing as a lifestyle produces greater blessings coming your way. The Message translation for Proverbs 11, 24 and 25 says, "The world of the generous gets larger and larger, but the world of the stingy gets smaller and smaller." Isn't that good? The world of the generous gets larger and larger. My world has increased. My world has gotten larger and larger. You know, when I just think about that little house that Carol and I moved into when we first came to Fort Worth, I talked about it in one of the other sessions. Just a little tiny wood frame house, and I'm serious, it should have been condemned before we moved in it. It was so bad. It had these wood floors. The heat didn't work in it. And we had gone off on a meeting And we left our daughters, Terry and Jerry, with two ex-hippies that we'd led to the Lord. And they came in there to babysit our daughters while Carol and I went to Texarkana with Brother Copeland. And they felt so sorry for us. And those old cold floors that Terry and Jerry were kind of crawling around on, they went to a carpet place and got in the dumpster and got all the samples out of the dumpster, brought them back to our house, sewed them all together, all these samples. When Carol and I came in and opened the door, we like went blind. I mean, we called it our Joseph carpet, you know. And I remember one time Carolyn's mom and dad came to visit us, and our little bathroom was tiny, and it had been painted so many times that the windows were stuck. You could not pry them loose from the paint, you know. And my mother-in-law went in to use the restroom, and when she got ready to get out, the doorknob broke. It just kept turning and wouldn't open, and it was locked. And I had to get those windows open with a pry bar, you know, and bring my mother-in-law out of the bathroom through the window. You know, and every time I came home from work at Brother Copeland's office, it was just a few blocks from there, a little small office. I'd come home, and the one tree out in the front yard, and it's a little small lot, I mean, tiny, tiny place. And I told Carol, I said, you know what? Every time I drive up to this place, it seems like every demon in hell is sitting in them trees saying, you're going to die, you're going to die, you're going to die. It'll never work, it'll never work, it'll never work. I said, we got to get out of this place. We got to believe God to get out of here. It was so poverty, stricken and poverty environment. I thought, how in the world are we going to survive in a place like this? So what did we do? We started sowing our way out of that situation. We didn't have a lot of money. You know, sometimes our seed wasn't more than a handful of coins. I remember now, you know, people find it hard to believe, but I actually did this. You can ask my wife. Things got so tough at times, and we had no money, and I didn't have milk for my babies, you know, and I would walk down Seminary Drive and find Coke bottles. I mean, remember when you could get a deposit for a Coke bottle? And I'd walk down Seminary Drive and pick up Coke bottles and take them to the grocery store, turn them in, get 2 cents apiece, I think they were, and get enough money to buy milk for my babies. Well, folks, that was a long, long time ago. And I have sown my way out of that situation. And look how big my world has gotten. Amen. Look how big my world has gotten. The Bible says, once again from the Message, the world of the generous gets larger and larger, but the world of the stingy gets smaller and smaller. The New International Version says, a generous person will prosper. I love that, will prosper. Everybody say, will prosper.
Will prosper.
Look at your neighbor and say, are you a generous person? Then tell him, then you will prosper. God is saying that the more we make giving our lifestyle, then the more He will pour out upon us. Simply put, you can't outgive God. Listen to what Paul said. This is an interesting concept. Go to Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4. We're talking about developing a lifestyle of giving. In Ephesians 4, Paul is giving us some very powerful instruction about don't give place to the devil. You know, be angry and sin not. Don't let the sun go down upon your wrath. Let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth. Grieve not the Holy Spirit. But notice verse 28. Let him that stole steal no more, but rather let him labor. Now, you could put in parentheses where it, right after let him labor, just like honest people do. Okay? That's what he's talking about. This is not instruction just for the thief. He's saying, if you're stealing, stop stealing. Labor with your hands like the honest person does, working with your hands the thing which is good, that, or you could put, so that he may have to give to him that needeth. Ain't that an interesting concept? Sounds like to me, Paul is saying, stop saying, I work for a living, and start saying, I work for a giving. Yes. Amen? Amen? He's saying, labor with your hands, you know, earn wages, but have in your mind the purpose of my job and the purpose of me laboring with my hands and the purpose of me earning wages is so that I will have seed to sow to those that are in need. See, that's developing a lifestyle of giving. I'm telling you what, when you go to this higher level, then I work for a living. You know, what do you do for a living? Well, I'm a plumber. What do you do for a living? I'm a mechanic. What do you do for a living? Well, I'm an attorney. Instead of on that level, take it up to the next level. And when somebody says, what do you do for a living? So, I live to give. Amen. I don't work for a living. I work for a giving. The money that I earn, I look at it as seed for sowing. What do you suppose would happen? You know, God only asked us to give 10% of it, the money we earn. He only asked us to give 10%. And He said, I'll open the windows and pour out blessing you can't even contain. What do you suppose would happen if you got to the place where you gave Him 90% and you lived on 10? What in the world would happen then? Well, a man by the name of R.J. Letourneau found out. He did that. And he became an extremely wealthy man. He made a vow to God. I'm not going to just give you the tenth. I'm going to get to the place where I give you 90% of my income. And the tenth he lived on was millions and millions and millions. Amen. Wow. God gave him a dream. And that dream was utilized during World War II. And it made him an extremely wealthy man. And he gave God 90%. Amen? So, our job is a means by which we gather up seed for sowing. Can you say amen? That's developing a lifestyle of giving. That's the way Carol and I approach our income. It's not, you know, what else can we do with this? Our first thought is tithe and sowing. Remember what we said in Galatians? Be mindful to be a blessing. Be mindful to be a blessing. In fact, before I even came over here this morning, hallelujah, I was able, and I say this to the glory of God, I was able to sow $25,000 into another man's ministry. It's in great need right now. Amen. Amen. Why? Because the world of the generous gets larger and larger. And you know, I didn't cry as the check was leaving. You probably haven't even heard about it yet, Vicki, and you're in the accounting department. Well, I sent a note to Carol. Okay. And I didn't cry. I sent that memo to Carol with great joy. You know, great joy that I was able to do that. And I know God set me up for something larger. But you know what? I'm at the place in my life, even if He didn't promise a harvest, I'd do it anyway. Amen. Because I live to give. I live to give. When you develop a lifestyle of giving, there's no way you can outgive God. Paul is saying, once again, that we should look at any form of income that comes to us, that some of it, a portion of it, should be for seed for sowing. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Amen. Ecclesiastes chapter 11, verses 1 through 6, the Living Bible says, give generously, for your gifts will return to you later. Now, that ought to help your faith. If you already know in advance this may not happen instantly, then that can rid you of the frustration. Amen? A lot of people, their attitude is, if it doesn't happen before dark, I'm not planning anymore. Well, you don't put the time frame on it. God does. Amen? And notice He says, give generously, for your gifts will return to you later. And it says, cast your bread upon the water, for in many days it shall return unto you. Well, see, that rids me of this pressure of, oh, if it don't come in by dark, then I'm not going to play anymore. No, it's already told me that there may be some time involved here. What's my responsibility? Keep on standing. Don't give up. In fact, keep on sowing. In fact, it goes on to say in the Living Bible, keep on sowing your seed, for you never know which will grow. Perhaps it all will. I like to say that this way. Keep on sowing, because you never know. It may be the next seed you sow that produces your breakthrough. Yes. Amen? Just keep on sowing, because you never know. The next seed you sow could be the one that causes the breakthrough. What you need to realize is that even when it looks as though nothing is working, God is working behind the scenes. Amen. Just like that little woman that I talked about who gave us the $30,000 for the medical facility. I had no idea that God was talking to a woman in a jogging suit. He didn't let me in on that. Now, one time while I was thanking him for it, he said, "By the way, son, when you get to the convention, there'll be a woman who almost misses the elevator, but she's going to have a $30,000 check for you. I told her to do that." No, he didn't let me in on that part. What if I had given up the night before that meeting and just said, "Forget it, God, it's not working. I don't know where you're going to get $30,000. The Bible says, if you faint, you reap not. Galatians 6, amen. If you faint, you reap not. No, God's always working behind the scenes. You don't know why you're sitting here, hopefully hanging on to every word that's coming out of my mouth. God is working behind the scenes. He could be preparing a financial break for you while you're sitting right here, right now. Amen. We had something happen here recently, and it's just a great example of how God works behind the scenes when you don't even know He's doing it. But I've got to the place where I know that. I know He's always working behind the scenes. I don't know who He's working with. I don't know how He's working, but I know He's working behind the scenes. There was a man that I had known for many years. I knew his father way back a long time ago. His father had a business was a very successful business. But when things changed in the economy, particularly the oil and gas industry, his business took a big hit and almost shut them down. Well, the father died and the son took over the business. And he's endeavoring to, you know, get this thing back on top again. And it was very difficult. And in the natural, it looked like they were going to lose everything. Well, he got a hold of a set of tapes, messages that I preached, and a book that I wrote on the same topic entitled From Devastation to Restoration. And he took those tapes in that book and he listened to them every time he got in his car. And he read that book every time he sat down to had some spare time. And he did this day after day after day after day. And he said, "As I read it over and over and I listened over and over, it got down on the inside of me that God could turn this business around." And he said, "And I made the decision that when he does, not if he does, but when he does, I'm going to sow major seed into Jerry Savelle's ministry." Now see, I had no idea God was talking to this man. You know, here I am, I'm believing God for, you know, major increase in income so we can do more for the kingdom of God. But I had no idea God was speaking to this man. I knew God was working behind the scenes, but I didn't know He was speaking to this man. And after a period of time, we received a large check in the ministry. It was a large check, a very nice check. I thought, praise God. And that's when he told me the story and what had happened and so forth. Well, you know, if he'd have never done anything else, that was an awesome blessing to us. But sometime later, here come another large check. Larger. Hallelujah. Over a period of a few years, this man has sown more money into our ministry than any other person in the last 45 years, to the tune of about $2.3 million. Amen. Over a period of time. Amen. Now, I didn't know God was talking to this man, but I'm sure glad I didn't give up. I'm sure glad I didn't say this stuff don't work. No, God was working behind the scenes. Amen. What do you suppose He's doing for you right now while you're sitting here receiving the Word? In fact, the Bible says, wisdom is the principal thing. Therefore, get it. It also says, and if you get it, it will exalt you. It will promote you. That's what you're doing right now. You had a dozen other things you could have been doing this morning. A dozen other things, you folks that are watching the DVDs or listening to the CDs, that you could have been doing right now. But you chose to put the Word of God first place. Guess what? You're headed for promotion.
Amen.
Amen. God's got a promotion for you. So when you develop this lifestyle of giving, then you will discover that you can never outgive God. Let me close it with this. Seven benefits of a lifestyle of giving. Number one, giving releases your faith in the faithfulness of God. Giving releases your faith in God's faithfulness. The Bible says in the book of James chapter 2 that it was when Abraham was willing to sow Isaac as an offering that his faith was made perfect. The Amplified says his faith reached supreme expression. Number two, giving establishes God's covenant in your life. Giving establishes God's covenant in your life. Genesis chapter 15, God made covenant with Abraham, and the first thing he began doing was give tithes of all of his increase, establishing his covenant. Number three, giving links you to the highest authority in the universe. Malachi chapter 3, God says, bring the tithes to me, and I will open the windows of heaven. Notice how your giving links you to the highest authority in the universe. Number four, giving releases the power of God in your behalf. Giving releases the power of God in your behalf. Once again, Malachi chapter 3, verse 11, God says, I will rebuke the devourer for your sake. That's God's power being released in your behalf. Number five, giving enlarges your capacity to receive from God. Giving enlarges your capacity to receive from God. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 6 through 9, it says that God will not only multiply, He will not only provide seed, but He will multiply your seed sown. So that enlarges your capacity to receive from God. Number six, giving increases your capacity to receive more of God. Not more from God, that's number five, more of God. In Acts chapter 10, verses 3 and 4 is the story of Cornelius, a man who was a giver. And what happened? God visited his house. Not only that, but God used him to be the instrument through which the Gentiles were able to receive the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. So notice how his giving, he gave alms unto God, and the Bible says it came up to God as a memorial. So his giving increased his capacity to receive more of God. And then number seven, giving increases the fruits of your righteousness, which we've already dealt with that in a previous chapter. But greater peace, greater quietness, greater confidence comes when you have developed a lifestyle of giving. So I challenge you today to determine in your heart, if you haven't already done so, that you're going to develop this lifestyle of living to give. Life better than you've ever dreamed awaits the person who develops a lifestyle of giving. So let's make our confession together. Heavenly Father, I will never cease to thank you for your blessing on my life. And because I'm blessed, I'll spend the rest of my life being a blessing. As you increase my resources, I will increase my sowing. For I have learned the essence of living is giving. Give the Lord another shout of praise. Amen.
Did you get a lot of notes? You know, so many times, what do human beings do when a situation comes along? What do we do when a situation comes along? What do? Run. We run from the situation. As Isaac didn't run, he stayed and he sowed. Charles Capps, he stayed. God said, plant. He planted. He even leased land. But Pastor Jan, I can't hear from God. Oh, yes, you can. This word right here, it says when you get in a situation, you want to hear God's word? When you get in a situation, sow your way out. There, you just heard from God. You used to think, oh, I just can't hear from God. I don't hear from everybody else. No, you heard it right there. See, when you hear God's word, you go into it and find what it says. You see the examples that God has given somebody else, and now you take that to heart. Would it be? Yeah. Now, Jerry could have given up, but he didn't. He would not give up the word of God. But the biggest thing that human beings do is we run from situations, and we keep on running, and we keep on running, and before you know it, we fall on our face because we keep on running. Instead of sticking with the situation, because remember, the devil's trying to test you, not God. The devil's trying to see if he can stop you from your destiny. It's up to you if you stop. I don't stop. God says to me, you got great blessings coming, sweetheart. And I said, I'll take it. I know it. I know it without a shadow of a doubt. I don't give up. I'm like that bulldog that just doesn't give up. So don't run from your problem. Don't look for some other source. And God will be your source, and he will bless you in the middle of the famine. Now, just think, what if I am blessed? I am blessed. I had a friend that they were married, and after they were married, she came to know the Lord. He didn't. And she wanted to sow. Boy, was that a fight constantly. Still to this day, a big fight. You guys don't know him. And I was like, honey, sow your way. He won't let me even pay the tithe. I would say, goodbye, sweetheart. That's not a good mate to have. When money means more to them than God, you're going to have a lifelong battle. Do you think? I'm blessed that I got a man that before he came to know Jesus, I told him about tithing, and what did he say? Well, I guess we've got it then. How is that? I'm blessed. So now, the world's way is not to give your way out. It's to work harder. True? True? I'll get myself another job. I'll try to find another source. I'll go ask somebody. Right? Wrong. That is not God's ways. And what does it say in Isaiah? His ways are higher than your ways. His ways are not your ways, meaning the world's ways. So he said, this is how you get yourself out of a situation. So now, sow yourself out of negative situations. Now, don't raise your hands, but I think everybody gets into a negative situation sometime or another, right? You can run, but you're going to run right into a wall. But start giving your way out of the situation. Well, it's not money, Pastor Jan, it's relationship. That's what I mean, so you're out of that whole situation. God will take care of it. Then we don't have to worry, do we? Cornelius sowed his way out, didn't he? He wasn't even a household of God. But he saw Jesus, and he did it. And what happened? His whole household got saved. Anybody you need to know, come to know Jesus. Anybody in your life? You know what? I sowed by sticking with God and not going back with my family when they tried to get me to go back to the world, back to the church we were in. And I got almost every one of them today. Oh, it didn't happen overnight. No, I did a lot of squalling and bawling, but I never gave up on this word because this is the only truth there is. You know that, don't you? So now, between sowing and reaping, like he said, it's important, it's exciting. It's up to us what we do. When you get that heart of giving generously, you're going to be blessed. You know that? Now, the seven benefits of lifestyle of giving. Just take this right down. Number one, giving releases your faith in the faithfulness of God. Giving releases your faith in the faithfulness of God. Two, giving establishes God's covenant in your life. You got a covenant with God. What does that mean? That means he's got your back. He's got your back. You can give things to the Lord and you can say, now I know everything's going to be all right. But the devil is going to attack and attack and attack, and he's going to make everything look bad, and he's going to try to get your butt running the other direction away from the truth. That's the way the devil works. Number three, giving links us to the highest authority in the universe. Wow. Is that awesome? Giving links us. And I'll copy this out and email them to you if you want them to. Okay? Giving links us to the highest authority in the universe. And I'll put the scripture behind it too. Okay? But guys, when Pastor Kenny and I got onto this, it's like, oh, guys, if you just get this, no matter what situation comes at you, I don't care if it's sickness, disease, I don't care if it's a relationship, I don't care if it's your work, I don't care if it's your money. This is the only way, you guys. This is the only way. It works every time. Now, verse 4, giving releases the power of God in your behalf. The God of the universe, right? 5, giving enlarges your capacity received from God. Look at Jerry. Look at Kenneth. These guys were dirt poor, lived in shacks, couldn't even afford a new pair of shoes. They had holes in the bottom. Couldn't afford to eat, pick up pop bottles. That's fun. Number 6, giving increases your capacity to receive more of God. Ooh, I love that. Okay? 7, giving increases the fruits of your righteousness. What does that mean? That means that God opens the windows of heaven, and no matter what you're going through, he is going to release blessings of righteousness in your life. You're going to go, I didn't even ask for that. So how do we activate the Abrahamic covenant? Through faith and obedience. See, it's all back to here, God, or guys. It's all back to being, be obedient. It's really hard to understand sometimes, and you really feel like that just ain't right because that isn't the way the world works. God, don't you know that? Ta-da! Is that stupid? Put a gun to your head. This is the only way to work. I've found that for years and years, and it really works. In response to our faithful tithes and offerings, God promises to open the windows of heaven, pour out a blessing so great that we won't be able to contain it. God himself does the pouring. That's what I like. What do you want? What do you want? See, when you give like this here, you then say, Lord, I gave. Memorize Malachi 3:10. Memorize those scriptures so that every time the devil makes it look like things aren't going to go right, no, I know everything is going to be all right because I found it in the Word. I know what it says. I'm going to bank my life on that. This is it. This is the beginning, and that this is it. We got it, don't we? So, can you trust God? You can trust no one else, not even yourself, like you can trust God. Now, this is a question. When we give to the Lord and his work, what does he guarantee? Freedom from fear. You know, just think, everybody's got fear in their life. You know, somebody hears that they have the big C word, cancer. What do? Start preparing for a funeral. That's just a time to start preparing to sow so you can reap. And then take the word of God and let it, medicine just flow over you. When I don't feel good, I'll put myself on music. I'll put on some preaching stuff so that just, that medicine continues to flow over me. When my mind gets squirrely, I turn on songs. I let that medicine flow because the devil is attacking me. So you can get rid of, you can have freedom from fear, anxiety, worry, stress, unrest, loss of sleep, and so on. How do you want to live? God is working behind the scenes. Is that good? I just get so excited over each one of these. Pastor Kenny, do you have something to share? Okay, sir.
Well, I was listening to the video, and Jerry says promotion. So I'm looking for a promotion. That's my goal. I'm looking for a promotion. So he did it for Jerry. He can do it for me also. So I'm looking for a promotion. Now, the other thing I wanted to do was, you know, in a short time, we're going to take up our tithes and offerings. But the other thing is, You know, we've been saying this, you know, name your seed. Are you having trouble naming your seed? I want to help you out a little bit. If you're having trouble naming your seed, right here, there's a whole bunch of names that you can name your seed. And I know certain people in this room would really like to see some of those named. Right, youth group? Yeah? Right?
Amen.
Right, yes. Right, Max? That need that room, don't we, Max? So there you go. There's some, if you don't know how to name it, there's some names. So just before the ushers come and we take up our tithes, a couple things I want to say. Genesis 3:1 says, "Now the serpent," who's the serpent?
Satan.
"Satan was more cunning than any beast of the field." The serpent is a symbol of Satan, just like you replied. Other Bible translation says he's subtle, shrewd, clever, crafty, and sneaky. He's got quite a title, don't he?
Yeah, he does.
So that tells us we must keep our guard up. We have to keep our guard up because he's, you know, he may do it one way, but he's got all these titles where he can come at you in other ways. So we need to keep our guard up. 1 Peter 5:8 through 9 tells us, "Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, is like a roaring lion, walking about to seek whom he may devour, whom he resists steadfast in your faith." You know, even though you got all this faith and everything, he's still going to find a way, sneaky, clever, crafty. He's going to look for some way to get at you. So, and, you know, especially when you come through some hard times, that's when he really, I got him right where I want him. So we have to stay steadfast in our faith. You know, want to make this clear, he is not a lion. He's not a lion, not a lion at all. He goes about roaring as if he was a lion, but he's not a lion at all. He's just trying to act like one. And then it's up to us to make sure that we put him in his place. So the lion in our life is really, the lion in our life is really our master, Jesus, God. That's the lion. He is the lion of the tribe of Judah. And that's who we got to always make sure that we recognize who the lion really is. So in the same verse of 1 Peter 5, notice that it says he doesn't say he devours everyone he seeks. Doesn't say that in that verse. He says he goes about looking who he can devour. Now, why do you think that scripture says that he goes about looking who he can devour? Because Satan knows that we want to drop our guard, and then he can get at us.
That's right.
So that's why it says he goes about looking who he can devour. In 1 Peter 5, we not only learn what Satan's mission is, but we also learn how to deal with him. So if you look on that scripture, 1 Peter 5, you'll learn how to deal with him. So it says, we should be sober, we should be on the alert, because he's always looking for when he can attack you. And then you should be looking out, that you know that he's going to be going around looking to see who he can devour.
Amen.
And so this tells us that we need to keep our guard up at all times. We should always be on the alert. Be looking around you to see what's going on in your life, or maybe who you're associating with. You know, that's important. Sometimes you start associating with the wrong people, and pretty soon you start leading your lifestyle like theirs is, and you know they're going down the tube, and they want to take you with them. You know, some people are in misery. They want you to be in misery, too. They hate to see you be healthy and wealthy and happy, you know. So again, we need to keep our guards up. So we need to remain steadfast in our faith. You know, keep your guard up by staying steadfast in your faith. The word of God will keep you steadfast. But you know something? You got to go to the Word. You can't just You can't just come into a Sunday morning or a Wednesday night. In the other times in your weekly, you need to go to the Word also. And, you know, a lot of times we say, I don't have time for this, I don't have time for that. But, you know, it's very simple. You know, Kenneth Copeland has made it really easy, and Gloria, that Faith to Faith book is so easy. Makes it so easy that you can do a little time, a little bit of devotion. And so, you know, you really don't have any excuses not to. So keep the Word, stay steadfast in your faith. I'm going to ask the ushers to come forward, and Deb is going to come and lead us in praise and worship. And we're going to take up our tithes and offerings this morning. So, Deb.
Your tithe and offering. Someone has made some quick decisions and they're already regretting what they've done. Name your seed, regret, and turn it around in Jesus' name. Whew. I don't know who's that for, but it's just going right through my body. So just ask God for forgiveness, and he said it's going to be a hard one, but you got to do it. Thank you, Jesus. Let's just pray in the spirit. Koriete rio kario to koriete. Aba koriete rio kario kasio rie alo loko ba o kori lelele kioto. Aba koriete rio koriete. Thank you, Jesus. Pastor Kenny, go.
Our offerings. Stretch your hands forward this morning as we do. Father, we come before you. We give you praise. We give you glory. Father, we just thank you that you have given us that opportunity that we can work so that we can give, Father, that we work towards that goal, Father. Father, we want to further your kingdom with our tithes and our offerings, Father, and we give you all the glory and praise in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Amen. Want to do communion, Pastor Jan?
Communion. Oh, because we have a covenant. He's the turnaround God. He's the Lion of Judah. Satan goes around, like you said, like a roaring lion, seeking whom he devour. He has lost his power. Remember, but Satan did have power.
Amen.
So take back what belongs to you. Don't mess with the devil. Oh, God, I worship you. This again, are we flickering?
Yeah.
Well, look at that.
Disco lights are going.
Disco lights. Does that mean you got to dance, Pastor Kenny? Where's Aaron? He's like that, whatever that is. Oh, yes.
Oh, thank you, sweetie.
I just have to get a selfie. I put hand lotion on in the morning. I shouldn't do that. No, I've got it now, but it keeps on slipping off. We have a covenant. And when you have a covenant, there is nothing impossible for God.
Amen.
Do you agree?
Amen.
Well, I believe it. And that settles it. It's done. It's finished. So, Father God, I stand in agreement with you.
Yes.
You died, Jesus. You took every miserable situation we've gotten ourselves in.
Yes.
Oh, la 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 kiyoko toko la la kiyoto. We have a hard time trusting God. This is Him. We have a hard time trusting Him. So we trust in ourselves. Our emotions get us into more trouble than you could shake a fist at. Do you realize that? It's like this. Put the brakes on and stop. You never saw, well, maybe you saw a horse show. I know, like, my lady used to do that, my horse. Come running up to me, I'd be out there. She'd come around, slam those feet up. She never hit me. But she was so excited to see me. That's the way we have to be with some things. We have to put the brakes on the evil that's speaking to our minds and hearts. Stop it in Jesus' name, he says. Right? We've got the victory. We got the victory. Say, I've got the victory.
I got the victory.
I'm strong in the Lord.
I am strong in the Lord.
And in the power of His might.
And in the power of His might.
No weapon formed against me can prosper. Any tongue that rises against me in judgment, I will show it to be in the wrong. Now, how do you show it to be in the wrong, folks? By speaking the way you want it and not the way the devil wants it. Whenever we go against God's word, we're speaking idle words. That means we've given the authority to the devil. Take it back. Say, you shouldn't have done that. Shouldn't have done that. Whenever somebody came up against my kids when they were young, you know, and as they were growing, I'd tell you, I came out and my legs were flying, my hands were flying, just get out of my way because it was a little tornado coming. You know what I'm talking about. We have got the victory, so let's eat because of our covenant in Jesus' name. Thank you, Father. And then this is our miracle. This grape juice signifies the blood of Jesus. And what does the blood do? It made you righteous. It made you righteous. Listen, you can't sin. But if you screw up, you're going to suffer the consequences. So ask God to help you to turn it around. Just say, Lord, help me. Right? See, that's why I don't want to screw up, because then I got to suffer the consequences and go back and tell Pastor Kenny I'm sorry or something. That is so hard. You know what I'm talking about. Hi, dear. We're going to drink because we are the righteousness of God in Jesus' name. Amen. Father, I thank you. Oh, how I glorify your holy name. For you are holy. There is no one like you. Are you going to make your announcements, dear?
No.
Okay.
Okay.
You may be seated.
Yeah, you can be seated. Just a few announcements. And Kim, I'll see if I can get this down pat today. You know, I've been practicing for a number of weeks now, so I'm getting close at it. So, first of all, this one's easy. Welcome, everybody, to El Shaddai Christian Fellowship.
Good.
And so the next thing, you can check out our website at www.elshaddai, and you can also watch the services on YouTube. You can search for ESCF Church, and those services are uploaded 5 hours after the live service. Women's Bible study on this coming Thursday, May 19th at 9:30. And then we have, can you put that up there next? Guys,
oh,
recognize
and they're not
that
here.
Young man?
They're, that's so, Jacob. He's not here.
That's Jacob's and his graduation. You know, I can't see what the date is. Do you,
May 29th
is his graduation, so.
Yep, Sunday, May 29th through 6th.
That's the part. Okay. So they're not here today, but
no.
I know everybody wants to support Jacob and wish him well in his graduation.
He's good at track.
Yeah. And then got the next picture there. Yeah, there he is, cross country. And he got into that, and he really didn't want to get into that, but he's done very well on it.
Can you tell which one is Jacob?
Yes.
Amen. You can tell him. Oh,
41.
Yep, 41.
Okay.
You saw him, right?
Yeah.
In case you can't see the 41.
Shorter?
He's just, what?
Nothing.
Do I have to hurt him? Anybody tell me? Go ahead.
And then we have another graduation. And that's Keegan's graduation.
Amen.
And is that the date of the graduation or is that the date of the party? Okay. That's the date of the party. Graduation for Keegan. And it's at the Frederickson household at Buchanan Street.
That's Debbie and Kenny, not mine. Debbie and Kenny.
Well, we don't live in Buchanan Street. So.
That street is
Road. Okay.
Road.
Put it in your GPS, you'll find it. Okay.
Oh, that's heads.
And it's at, it's on June 5th, and it's between 3 and 7. So, what day is Keegan graduating?
Saturday the
28th. Okay, so the 28th.
Mm-hmm.
You got that down, Keegan? Don't be late. Okay, then the next slide up there, again, the Christian Academy is enrolling kids 3 weeks to six weeks to 2 years old. So they're doing that.
And we're going to have some classes in the summertime for the kids that are a little bit older with the Montessori's teaching.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Then also, if you want to mark your envelopes for the child rescue thing, you can do that. Just put a note on your tithing envelope that you want something to that.
Mm-hmm.
And then also Liberty Council, you can learn more if you go into that website. You can learn more about human trafficking there. So, and then the next health and wellness class is June 13th, and they're still getting charged yet, so you
can, amen,
so we can do that. Then we have a couple birthdays this coming week. We have Matthew Hansen, which is this week, and they're not here today either.
Yeah.
And the other one is?
Aaron.
Aaron Thiel.
Aaron.
On the 20th. It is his
is he the father of Levi Kenneth Thiel? Just checking.
So it is his birthday also this week. The 20th is which day? That's about Thursday? You know, Friday? Okay.
It's the 15th today.
All right. So, Debbie, you want to sing happy birthday to your co-worship leader?
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Aaron.
Happy birthday to you. All right. And then the next slide. You want to put that up there? And
yes, this is, it's maybe kind of hard to see this, but Jerry Savelle came for a football game and went with Pastor Kenny. And you can see Kenny, myself, and Jerry, and his grandson, Dylan. We took them over to Simon's Cheese, and, I mean, they had a ball. So, okay, next one.
Next one.
And there is at our kitchen table. There's little Dylan to the right. Now, we met his mother this last January, Jerry's daughter, Jerry Ann. We met her, had lunch with her and so on. And then Jerry, Pastor Kenny, and myself. I think that's Big Mikey at the sink.
Could be. But, you know, Jerry talks in the video today. He talked about having, sitting at people's dinner table and having lunch with them. Well, we have a privilege to have Jerry sit at, you know. Mm-hmm. I don't know, was this was on the day after the game, or was that? Because that, the day we went to the game, go back a little bit, it was a December game and it was snowing like crazy that day.
Yeah.
And he had a hard time getting into Green Bay to be in time for the game. Mm-hmm. And so when I picked him up at the airport, we had to come back to our house quickly and change and stuff and go to the game, get some clothes on, be decent, because it was a wet snow. Mm-hmm. And so when we came back that night and we sat by our table, and, well, I don't know, we had...
Well, when you came back from the game, Kenny was in the car yet, and Jerry comes kind of running in the house. He said, boy, was that a good game. That was fun. And thank you for the hat. I had bought him and Dylan these hats. I knew they'd have to have them instead of just a stocking cap. But anyway, I said, well, I've got something else for Dylan. I taped the game. And I put it onto a DVD. Oh, he's going to love that. So we had a wonderful time. And every time we're at doings where Jerry is, we always get together and say hi. So he is a blessing. So, and he lives the Word of God.
Oh, yeah.
He lives the Word.
All right. So let's go before the Lord and pray for our military. Amen. And our police also. So let's do it.
Father, in the name of Jesus. We exercise our covenant authority over the enemy. We demand the killing, destruction, and confusion over the American soldiers, our police, and all who stand with them to stop now. We charge the angels to protect and guide them, and we speak the blood of Jesus and the protection of the 91st Psalm over them now. Jesus is Lord over Iraq, Afghanistan, United States of America, and all of the earth.
Amen. And then one other little announcement. We got a couple visitors today all the way from Florida. So welcome back, Dixie.
Hey, they're not visitors. They stay here.
we welcome you guys back. Good to have you back. Good to see your faces again. Mm-hmm. And did you have to use the GPS to find your house? Yeah, I don't know.
Yeah.
No, the GPS says this is where they live, and I.
Okay, I want to see the dancing kitties. I want to see those
all
dancing
right.
kitties.
There's dancing
kitties. Get charged.
That's
look
what
at that. Those, how do you like that?
Those cats were at the meeting, the health class, and that's what happened. They charged up. And then the next slide there also. Just like we were talking about, you know, you can
keep studying the word.
You can do everything, you know, and if you fall away from the word, not stay, you know, touch on it now and then, you need to do it. So keep studying. And we got one more. When anxiety was great within me, your consolation brought me joy. Amen.
You know what you do? Every once in a while, when you really get down, bogged. Does anybody ever get bogged down? Everybody. What's the best thing to do? Ha, ha, ha. Ha, ha, ha. Why? Because God is laughing at the devil, so why don't you join God and laugh at the devil before you go out and you'll get yourself a hearty laugh going on? I do that. The other day I was sitting by my computer that was on, well, that was over here on Wednesday, and I started, ha, ha, ha. And before you know it, I'm having a good time all by myself. God laughs at the works of the devil. Isn't that great? So, Father God, I plead the blood. Why don't you stand? I plead the blood over each and every person here.
Yes.
I thank you for increasing every one of the lives, Father God, of these your children. Father, they gave today. They named their seed. And now, Father, they're going to stop looking at the seed, but they're going to look at the harvest from the seed. In the precious name of Jesus. Do you receive it?
Amen.
Amen. Glory to God. Have a marvelous day.